Hello. So today what I'm going to look at is the process of working with a tablet. I have an XP pen tablet, but you could do this with pretty much any tablet that you've got. And putting art onto a physical format, in this case a watercolor card, that starts out as an image on your tablet. So I'm going to show you the process of getting it on the tablet and then getting it to be on the card. I've got my tablet image set up to be about the same proportions as the card that I'm trying to print onto so that I can keep the image looking about the same when I'm working in one or the other. That'll just make it easier. So to start with, I've got a base image, which is a watercolor card I had painted previously, and my aim is to create a template out of this so I can then use that template going forward fairly easily to make additional cards that are similar to it but not exactly the same as it. So what I'm doing over on my laptop right now is navigating to bring up the image of that card as a layer. So this is a February themed card, and I want to be able to make this for March, April, May, June, July, and so on, and I want to keep the main details of the house the same and then be able to swap out the different seasonal aspects of it. So I've just sized the image down a little bit so that it fits better on this screen layout that I've got. And now I'm going to create a new layer, and I'm going to trace the key aspects of this image so that I have that as a starting point going forward. So depending on which tablet you're using, you want to make sure that you get the image that you've brought in as your starting point to be sized to fit the space available. And you know, pretty much any tablet will give you these kinds of options to do a little bit of tweaking to make it larger or smaller or slide it a little to the left or to the right or so on. And once you get all of that set, it's time to start the tracing process. So you create a new layer on top of everything else, and then you choose whatever tool you want to do the tracing with. I like to choose a pen, and I like to choose a black pen. You know, some people like to do this in pencil. It just depends on you. I like to have that black pen outer look in my designs that I do. And now I'm going to go along the key lines in my original artwork and get those highlighted in pen. So this is a completely separate layer. It's a layer above my base layer, so I'm not affecting the base drawing at all. I'm creating a new layer that has these pen lines in it. And it's good to do it in sections, so that way if you make a mistake on one of the sections, you can just undo that particular section without having to undo, you know, a whole bunch of art. I like to do things like a curve in one swoop so that it stays fairly consistent, but you know, depending on how you tend to draw, you may want to do a curve in separate little pieces or so on. And you could say you could have the program automatically trace out things, but I like doing this by hand because I like the hand-drawn feel of it, and also it's just fun for me. So I'm tracing around the different key parts of the design that I know are going to stay the same as I do the March scene and April scene and May scene and so on. So again, the aim of this process is to create a starting template, and then I'll have this starting template to be able to use. I could use it for doing more tablet-based art if I wanted to, but my actual aim is to then be able to use this to create more watercolor or colored pencil art in a physical form. So that is the section that's going to come up next, which will show you how to then transfer this template that we've got over into a physical format. So I'm just going to let the soundtrack run as I finish the tracing process. But if you have any questions about how a tracing process works, just let me know, and I am happy to help with that part. Thank you. Alright, so I finished the left-hand window, and now I want the right-hand window to be able to reasonably match it. So what I've got are guidelines, and you have guidelines in pretty much any tablet that you work with. These guidelines help you see if things are straight, if you want those to be straight. So you can usually have horizontal and vertical guidelines. And I'm just going to set up a horizontal guideline across the top of the first window so that when I draw the second window, I can make sure they start in about the same place. I drew the original one freehand, and it looks like I got it pretty close to where it was supposed to be, but it's always good to check these kinds of things if you want them to be pretty much the same for whatever reason. So now I'm just pulling down a second guideline to do the bottom of the window to make sure that everything lines up. And it does. So it's good to know that guidelines are in there if you need to use them for some reason. And if you just want to draw everything freehand and have it be however it is, then that is fine too. It is up to you as the artist. So once you think you've got everything traced, the nice thing about layers is that you can just turn off the original layer and see what you've got showing up and figure out where you still need to do some work. And then you could turn on the original layer again and then put in the additional lines that you need to be able to get your template image to be completely finished. Okay, so when you think that you're close, you can do a little bit of cleanup and get whatever little parts you think are not quite right. In my case, I had the snap to guides turned on by accident, so there was a little bump out in the top of the window that I'm gonna try to take care of here. Get that under control. But once you are set with this, then you would save this image as your new starting point. And then it's a question of printing this out and being able to use that as a tracing tool to get this onto watercolor or mixed media paper. I actually have a printer that I can print directly onto watercolor or mixed media, and you could do that if you wanted to, if you had that kind of printer. But it would be worth noting that then all of this black stuff would be ink, and that may not be the kind of look that you want to have it be printer ink image. It may be that you'd rather do it a more traditional way where you have this design penciled in, and then you use actual ink to go over it with ink, and then use watercolors or colored pencils or whatever you want to do for the coloring aspect of it. But in whatever way that you want to tackle that, your first step would be to print this out onto a printer to get something physical that you can work with. So now we're ready to do the printing of this digital image onto a piece of paper. And again, for my purpose, I'm going to print it onto a piece of paper so that I can then trace it with a light table onto watercolor paper and mixed media paper. but it could be that you're just looking to make a bunch of cheap copier paper versions for a bunch of kids to color on, and that is perfectly fine too. Or you could print them onto cardstock paper and so on. If you do your printing direct onto the surface you're then going to color, it's worth noting that these black lines are going to be printer ink black lines, and that you'll then color in those lines, which may be the look you're hoping for. But in my case, I want to be able to then trace it with pencil so that I have a starting point of pencil to then further make my traditional artwork out of. So this technique will work for either type of art depending on what you're after. So all I'm doing right here is sending it off to my printer, and I'm going to print it on regular copy paper as a starting point. And then I will also print a copy onto cardstock paper, because part of why I'm doing this project is to then do a subsequent project to show how colored pencils work or don't work on a variety of different paper surfaces with the exact same starting image. So this is how I'm creating all of those starting images on different types of paper. I'll have it on printer paper, on copy, on printer paper, on cardstock, on mixed media paper, and on watercolor paper. And then my cat Zuzu always has to come over and help when I'm doing anything artistic, so I'm surprised that I made it this long without having Zuzu come and step all over everything or start gnawing on my pen. She likes to be an assistant in all of these kinds of processes. So the various printer versions are printing right now. In a moment we will be able to start the next part of this process, which is working with the light pens. Alright, so here we've got the printed version on regular copy paper and on cardstock. And now I'm going to be setting up the light table to be able to transfer these images from these two original formats onto watercolor paper and onto mixed media paper. So a light table, or light square, or whatever you want to call these things, is just a rectangle of light. It does not have any sort of display unit, which is good because you're going to be doing a lot of pressing and tracing onto these, and you don't want that surface to be touch sensitive. You just want it to be a nice solid square of light that you can press into and do things into without worrying about wearing down the surface or wearing down styluses or all those other kinds of things. And they tend to be nice and inexpensive, which is an additional bonus. So I am just plugging in the unit. Alright, so as you can see, it's just a glowing square of white light, which is perfect for tracing items. And then you put your original design down on the lower level. And I'll just pull out the copy paper version of this and get it situated on the light table. And then you put your destination layer, in my case the mixed media or watercolor paper, down on top of this, and because of the light table's brightness, you're able to see right through it to see the design and be able to then trace it. So I like to trace these with pencil, and this happens to be Strathmore watercolor card that I'm using as my destination layer. And there are pieces of tape or magnets or all sorts of other things that you can use to hold it steady to make sure that the images don't slide in relationship to each other. But I'm just going to use my hands because I want to do this quick and easy. And as you can see, Zuzu is being helpful in the process. She is wonderfully helpful, especially when pencils are involved. She really loves to chew on them and lend a hand, so I usually have to give her a chance to chew on it for a minute or two before I can then work on my art project without having the pencil being moved around and wiggled with feline assistance. We have finally gotten Zuzu to have her fill of pencil and snuggling time, and we can get back to this whole doing the trace work onto the image. So, like I said, if you want to tape it down or use magnets to hold it down, you can certainly do that. I usually find it's fine just to hold it down with my hands, especially if it isn't too complicated a deal. I think this is enough of an image that I can get through this without having to tape it down or hopefully worry about Zuzu coming back to you, maybe a little lend a hand. So once again, I am now tracing over this outline that I created in my XP Pen tablet, and I'm doing this with pencil because I want to do this as a watercolor painting, and I like starting with a pencil sketch, and then from there I'll have some of it stay pencil, and then some of it I will ink with a waterproof ink pen, and then I will do watercolors for the colored areas after that. So this is the tracing part of the process.
Thank you.
Alright, so when you get to the point that you think you've traced everything, you want to try to gently lift it up to just double check that before you lose your alignment. And in this case, I have traced everything that I wanted to, so we've got the original on the printer paper, and then we've got my copy of it, which is on watercolor paper. And then we've got this other original, so I've got a number of different versions of it now that I can work from. And I'll do this again, putting it onto mixed media paper so that you can see the process. So again, I have a starting image that I printed out from my printer as the base level, and then I have the mixed media paper laid on top of that, and I am using a pencil to trace the image, which I can see through the paper because of the brightness of this light table, and be able to trace out my design in pencil and know that it will be a fairly accurate representation of the overall template that I want to be using for this series. What I also like to do is label the backside of each type of paper that I'm using, especially if I'm doing paper comparisons, with what kind I used, because once you get 5 or 6 copies of an image lying around, it can be hard to remember, oh, this one was mixed media paper, and this one is watercolor paper, and so on. And also, if you do tests with different brands of paper, like Archer's watercolor paper versus Strathmore watercolor paper, it's always a good idea to label the back of it with which brand of paper you used, because that can be really useful for you as you go forward with your art career to keep track of, oh, look, the reds work really well on this kind of paper and the blues work really well on that kind of paper. So the more information you can remember for yourself about what you are working with, the better it'll be for your research and for knowing how you want to proceed with things going forward. And just when we thought that we had had enough of Zuzu coming to help us, Zuzu decided that she wanted to come back and lend her feline assistance yet more. And I've got this image partway done, so I don't want it to slide. And of course she decides she's going to sit right on top of everything. You know, at least this isn't a pressure-sensitive device that could be damaged, is perhaps too strong a word, but not helped by having her laying on top of it. This is just a glowing light, but this is a little less than helpful for the drawing process. So I'm trying to keep everything in the same place and trying to draw under her head, which is not exactly the best way to do art. But you know, when you have a cat in the house, you have to make some concessions to the cat's assistance levels. So really, this design is pretty much done at this point. Just have a couple more little pieces to do, and I have to do it underneath Zuzu's body, which is alright. So I have now got 4 different versions of this exact same image, one of them on printer/copier paper, one of them on cardstock, both of those were printed straight out of the printer, and the one that I traced with pencil on the light table onto watercolor Strathmore card paper, and then one of them, which I just did here, which is onto Strathmore mixed media paper. So I will do a later video that shows how colored pencil works on all 4 different kinds of paper to show how the different textures of the paper affect the colored pencil process. But you can use this technique to be able to move an image from your digital device onto watercolor paper for doing watercolors, or colored pencil paper for doing colored pencil, or all sorts of different kinds of things. So this is a really good technique to learn And the devices that you need to be able to do this are the light table, which is this thing that Zuzu is laying on right now, the tablet, which is where you do your drawing and tracing and such, and then the tablets that I use need to be connected with a laptop, which is the thing in the top left. There are, of course, many tablets that work standalone that you don't need a laptop, so in that case, you would just need the tablet and then the drawing light table. So let me know if you have any questions about this process, and I could do specific videos about a specific subset of what's going on here. If something wasn't clear in this overall video, I am happy to help. So have a lovely day.